Feel free to cross-talk. Feel free to curse. We run it uncut. Not that you would ever do that working for Disney or Pixar, but you're welcome to. The idea is
I'll
run
curse. I'm technically not employed there, yeah, so there I can curse all I want, yeah.
You guys have been on this adventure for, what, 5-6 years now?
It has been a it's been a six-year process. I started on it in 2013.
Yeah.
You started then.
Yeah, I started in 2012, and I was on for 3 years.
So what was the first blush of this thing?
I don't think either of us were around for the first blush.
No, it all, that was all Lee Unkrich, yeah. And probably Jason Katz.
And Jason and Darla.
And Darla, yeah. Anderson. After they'd finished Toy Story 3, part of the process at Pixar when you're developing a new idea is to pitch three different ideas. And so Lee went into the development process, started developing three different ideas, and one of them was around the Day of the Dead. And I don't know that it was necessarily attached to a particular story.
When I got involved, yeah, there was, eventually.
Eventually.
When he pitched the idea, I don't know, I wasn't there, I don't know what he pitched, but eventually, they did develop a story that was pitched to me at my first interview. Mm-hmm. And it was you know, a 5-minute pitch. Here's what we want to do. And so that was the story that we started working with when I started. We left that story shortly thereafter, for lots of different reasons. And then at that point, the sort of the slate was re-cleared, mm-hmm. and we started putting together what would ultimately become the movie.
So when you came in, or you were not a Pixar employee, you were a writer from the outside world?
Yeah, we're strangers from the outside. That's what our name tags say. No, we're writers.
Can't use the pool.
We can now. We fought the fight. Writers are, yeah, we're brought on as consultants and as contractors. And so we come on, consultants who write and consultant there. We have other deals where we're consultants who don't write. So while I wrote on Coco, I also did consulting on some of the other projects that were going on, in development. But I was not doing writing services on them. So I would just sit in story meetings and, you know, help the other writers and the directors work through their ideas and just sort of generally be another voice in the room. So
like the spirit of the whole Pixar campus and everything, of everybody kind of pitching in the room.
Everybody, it's a big table and everybody's got a voice, and you either are going to speak up or you won't, and your ideas may fly or they won't, but it's kind of, you're encouraged to speak up and share your point of view and fight for it if you really believe in it, and make the case. And it is. It's very collaborative. I mean, I can't tell you how many times you go into one of those rooms and you're just stuck. And you get into one of those rooms and the thing you've been stuck on for 6 weeks, like, gets solved in 10 minutes. And you're like, oh, well, yeah, I guess we could just do that. It goes so fast sometimes when you're in those rooms. And it is actually thrilling to be part of that. I was living down here. I was a screenwriter. I started working up there. And within the first year, my wife and I decided that we were just going to move and live up. We live up there now. So, I'm not an employee, but I am sort of in the fold, I guess.
And the schools are better up there. That's the other.
I guess. Yeah.
I don't know if you have kids or not. But
I do. We're never involved in the schools down here, so I don't know.
Much safer. So you came along, and so the bones, so to speak, of the project evolved while you were on it as a writer.
Yes.
And so you took it to a certain point, and then you guys handed it off, or how did this?
Yeah, I mean, I was on for 3 years. Most of those 3 years, we were developing the film as a more traditional style musical, more of a, for lack of a better word, like an American Broadway musical, with the same sort of rules and structure and things like that. And I know you have spoken to this before, but at a certain point, it became clear that just wasn't feeling right and it wasn't going to work. And we all kind of, we knew we wanted a movie with music rather than a musical. And so that's when we looked at movies like Oh Brother and Once and some of these other movies that, and the movies from the sort of the golden age of Mexican cinema, which did this. And so the last draft that I wrote was the first sort of movie with music draft. Mm-hmm. And then at that point, you know, after being on it for 3 years, I was just kind of, I was tapped, you know, and it was time to move on to other things. And that's when Adrian came on and took over from there.
So I had, I am a Pixar employee.
That's true.
You don't just play one on TV. You
don't just play one on TV.
R1?
No, I started on this project as a story artist. So back when after the first version that then got stripped back down and rebooted, that's when I started drawing on the film.
Yeah.
And so I had the benefit of seeing all the versions of the story that we had tried. The kind of things that worked about the musical aspect, the things that didn't necessarily gel with the world we were building, a lot of different explorations of different types of stories about different types of conflicts. Always in Matt's very first draft, there were so many strong tentpoles of stuff that ultimately, like, I feel like Song for Coco, this
that never changed.
Climactic moment at the emotional climax at the end of the film was essentially identical from the very first screening to the to the final film, and then the ideas of the family not liking music and the family history of a musician, all of those were in there from the very earliest stages, but having had the benefit of seeing and drawing a lot of these different versions, when it got to the point where we decided to do just a movie with music in it, and we had done a lot of exploration of the characters, versions of the characters, I had accumulated a lot of ideas and a lot of thoughts of, I know all the stuff that Lee likes about this story, I know all the stuff that pulls at his heartstrings and the stuff that he wants to feature. And having come from, you know, almost a decade's worth of working on story at Pixar, I was like, I think I might know some ways visually, plot-wise, structure-wise, where we can do all those same things, but make them fit a little tighter and make them feel a little more of the world that Miguel lives in. But, you know, it takes that many years to realize, oh, this is what's important to us, this is what we don't want to lose, and then it takes a whole number of years after that to figure out, okay, how do we make it all connect? And that was kind of the point at which
And Adrian was like, he was the perfect person to do that, to be the one to step in, because, you know, so like I said, I've been working there on and off for the last 5 or 6 years, and there's a learning curve when you're just starting. I believe when anybody's just starting at Pixar, there's a learning curve for how things are done, just like you start at any company. But for writers, it's particularly it can be a real jolt, because the process is so highly collaborative and iterative. Like that, you have to do so many versions of the story and try so many different things, changing one variable at a time, sort of like almost like in a scientific method, trying to figure out exactly how this is going to work.
Which you're used to doing in your head?
Yeah, to a certain extent, but I think the key difference is I'm used to doing that alone.
Right.
Or maybe with somebody I really love and trust. Please read this, but don't tell anybody you read it, and tell me what you think, but don't tell me what you think. You know, you can, when you're writing on your own, you can be very precious. And so, as he was saying, as Adrian was saying, like he was there for all of the exploration. And it's sort of like, I can only imagine if there had to be somebody who had to like come in cold and get up to speed and then catch, and the project at that point really needed somebody like you to go, okay, I've heard it all, now let's hear all the pieces. We've taken the car apart, we've put all the pieces on the lawn, now let's put it back together and make this thing run, and it does. I saw the movie. I saw a version of the movie maybe a year or so after I wrapped. I came back to see a screening of it, and I was just like, "Oh, thank God!" I was like, "It looked so good. It was just so good." It was like, "Oh my God, this is the movie we were trying to make for years and years and years. You know, this is the rock we've been trying to push uphill." And I was so happy.
Yeah. So, did the rock seem particularly big to you as somebody who's been through this with other movies, or does it seem like a normal Pixar rock?
No, I don't know. I think they're all pretty big. This is the first time where I felt like I had to push so much of the weight of it. Mm. And to Matt's point, you know, I think you were writing on it for 3 years. I think by the time that I had finished the last draft before everything was in production, I had been on it for like 2.5 years writing. Mm-hmm. And there is a certain point at which like you're making these changes, and to you, because you've been in it and your head's been in it, they feel arbitrary. And it's like, I'm just moving pieces around. Yeah. I don't even know
if this is you lose perspective.
Any good. And it was very important at that point to have other people come in from other projects and give their feedback. But it's really hard, and it's a lot of, I think especially, like, this is a small story. Like for as big as the scope is in terms of the visuals and the audience that we're making it for and all of that, the story itself is very, you know, delicate and it's about, you know, a handful of characters and just what it means to be a person who has a dream that doesn't fit in alignment with their traditions or their family or what they believe that their family values. So that was always what I was trying to focus on. But in the back of your mind, there's always two things. There's one, like, this is a Pixar film, so yeah, it has to be Pixar quality. And then for me, it was also a little bit of, you know, I have to make this as good as I can so that just from the cultural standpoint, like, just to be able to show that a film of this subject matter with these types of characters is something that can be extremely high quality and that hopefully the public will receive well. I didn't want to mess it up on that angle for the rest of everybody.
The degree of difficulty, yeah, I mean, we could talk a lot about the degree of difficulty. This was the triple Lindy of movies in a lot of ways. Like, this was not... this is not a gimme from the beginning, from the first sort of stories that we put out. But one thing that I talk about this with other writers who come in, it's really intimidating when you first get there, because you're sort of walking onto this beautiful campus. You're outside of your home city, most likely, and so you're feeling generally out of place. And then you walk on campus and you see, you know, a giant Pixar lamp, and you walk in and there's Buzz Lightyear and Woody to greet you at the door, and there's Mike Wazowski, and there's Lightning McQueen, and they're everywhere, and you're like, oh my God, I have to actually create characters that can stand in a lineup with Buzz and Woody? Like, are you kidding? Like, I can't do that. I can't come up with somebody like that, that has that kind of emotional resonance, that has that kind of drive, that has that kind of when you look at the lineup of Pixar characters, it's a really intimidating lineup. It just is. And to sort of be faced with that on a creative level is like, okay, all right, here we are. We're in the NFL. Let's play. Let's go. You know, and
I actually found the number of cereals available more intimidating when I walked in there. But that's a whole other thing.
I'd
have to write a movie for them.
No. But it is. It can be very creatively intimidating. So to know that you got to do that and deliver the goods culturally, and to make sure that the story stands up and can stand alongside stories like Up. Mm-hmm. Or stories like Inside Out, as was being developed while we were working on Coco. Like, I don't know. It's you get real serious really fast. But it's fun too.
And that's the other thing is you have to remember is like you're aware of that when you go into it, but you also can't be thinking.
No, you have to forget it.
You have to be in the creative process. You have to. Know that, okay, that's hopefully, if everyone holds hands and says, you know, try our best, hopefully that's something we can achieve. But as we're making stuff, we cannot have that voice in our heads. Like we need to focus on the moment by moment. What is the thing that this story needs at this time to draw the audience in, to make you care about the character, to pay off on all the promises that we set up in the premise and in the world and everything. The only way to get through the day is to take it those small problems at a time and work with a wonderful team that's very creative and wants to have fun with it. Because if you show up every morning saying, okay, next masterpiece,
you're done.
Yeah, you're done.
If every word you write is like, you know, match point at the championships, you're really going to mess up royally. I just try to make myself giggle. That's all I try to do when I sit down to the typewriter, is that, like, if I can make myself giggle, I know things are gonna be okay.
So let's talk about the Latino of it all, I guess.
Yeah.
Or is it the Hispanic? I don't know which way we're going these days, which the right way to say it is.
Mexico would be both Latino and Hispanic. Yeah.
So Lee is not.
No.
Pixar generally is not. It's not a overwhelmingly Hispanic or Latino place. Was that an issue at all from the beginning? Was it something that was the idea was to pay honor to, or to how was that issue approached, since it wasn't?
It came up in my first meetings with Lee and Darla. When you get called up to write on something, you don't necessarily know what you're going to go be interviewed for. Sometimes it's just you're sort of being generally interviewed. This was specific, and so I had a whole long lunch with them, first time I was meeting them, before they ever told me what I was at Pixar to talk about. And that lunch was, hey, tell us about yourself. Where you been? What you doing? How'd you get involved in this? So I told about my own sort of work history, which happened to have a decent amount of stuff that had to do with Mexico and Mexican cinema and my travels through Latin America. And right before I was working on Coco, I had done a biography of Pablo Escobar. We talked about that. And
I want to see the Pixar version of that.
Yeah, well, we almost sent it as a writing sample. We were like, should we send this as a writing sample to Pixar? We don't know.
Young Pablo.
Yeah. I'm glad we didn't. It's a very different movie tonally. I guess I had sort of unwittingly said all the right things. And so when they pitched me the idea, like the background that I come from is not my ethnic background, but just in terms of how I was introduced to the movie business and my sensibilities was through working at the Sundance Institute. And so that was my first job out of college, and that is all about Sundance, especially the international programs, which is what I was doing, is all about supporting people who don't traditionally have voices and trying to help those people, help their stories reach international audiences. And so from my very first introduction to the movie business, it was all about who's not being listened to and how can we help them get listened to. So that was imprinted on me. And so when they said that they wanted to do a movie about Dia de Muertos, I was like, oh, okay. I know why that needs to happen. I know who that is going to be happening for. I'm like, I was already, they didn't need to talk to me about that part of it. I already knew what that part of it was going to entail and how challenging it was going to be. And how, as I was saying, like the margin for error was going to be really slim on that, and that it was going to have to be gotten right. But it was never it was always something that was so self-evident to me. Mm-hmm. That this would have to be, it'd have to just feel real. From the very beginning, I was like, this should feel like we found an old Mexican folktale and we adapted it the way that early Disney was adapting fairy tales. I was like, this should just feel like a story they've been telling for hundreds of years. And let's try to do that. Let's approach it with that way. And so in that regard, creating the story, I always felt like I was always trying to get out of the way of it and not put myself in it too much and really be like, just kind of step out of the way and say, like, what would what would the movie be that came out of Mexico? Does that make sense?
Yeah, and that is reflected in the fact that I started as a story artist, and I specifically requested to work on Coco if they were interested in having me, because I was very excited about this idea of a film that explored Mexican traditions, a Mexican family, which takes place in Mexico. And you know, they wanted to have me, and that was really good. But I noticed from the very first moment that I started on the picture, the core group was very dedicated to a thoughtful representation of this family and this culture. They wanted to do the research, and I had later learned that they very much wanted me to be a storyboard artist on that film. So it was a perfect match, but part of that was relying on, you know, like you said, we're not a overwhelmingly Latino population at Pixar, because we're a very diverse population at Pixar. So there are a lot of Latinos who, just like me, really wanted to lend their voices and lend their experience and lend their point of view into the storytelling. So as we did the research, as we joined up with our group of cultural consultants who, through every screening, were looking at the film, looking at the story, looking at the representation, and saying, these are the things you're doing right, these are the opportunities that you can still take advantage of, and these are the things that you've got blind spots for.
Was there a lot of that? I mean, is that...
Every single round of every screening that we had.
Even before that, they were at all the table reads for the script.
And is it uncomfortable as the...
God, no.
Or do you just feel like, thank God they're keeping me from stepping in it?
I was like, how was it? What'd you think? Like, please tell me. And they were like, it was great. Like, but here's some stuff. And I'm like, yeah, give me.
That guy with the giant mustache, get rid of him.
I remember one thing specifically in an early draft. Abuelita, I was writing her as my grandmother, who's Croatian, but she also had 7 kids, and so that family reminds me a lot of my family and that sort of that big family dynamic. But I was writing her like my Croatian grandmother. And I remember, I think it was Octavio, who was another storyboard artist on the film. He pulled me aside and he was like, I don't know, this is not, like, she wouldn't be that, like, she this is how she would direct her anger, you know? Whereas my grandmother would have been more just demonstrative in this way, culturally. It was just like, same feeling, but this is how it would come out. Like, oh, okay, I get it. So it was stuff like that, where it was just like course corrections. I don't think there was ever a ton, not certainly while I was involved, when anybody kind of had to pull the emergency brake and go, whoa, guys. You know, I mean, we were always generally in the right airspace.
No, fast mice running around.
I mean, like, I think you do really have to be, you have to try to make a mistake that broad.
Yeah.
But I think... the danger is kind of like the 1,000 paper cuts. The danger is making a lot of little mistakes.
And very important to that point, it's creating an environment where when you have little mistakes or something that someone watches, and like I've had the experience, well, I'll watch something and I'll say, like, I can't put my finger on why this is rubbing me weird, but there's something there. And to be able to have the room where you can say that, and then you've got multiple other people from the community watching it and hearing that note, then all of a sudden someone else will say, like, yeah, I was feeling that too. And then someone else will say, well, it's this thing. And then we all look at it as like, oh yeah, that's the thing that's making, and it's not, and sometimes it's accidental, sometimes it's subtle.
Right.
But those little things don't come out in the wash unless you create an environment where people can slow down and say, you know, and we, you know, when I'm writing a screenplay, I'm always reading it multiple times through different filters. One of those filters is pace. One of those filters is economy. One of those filters is characterization. And one of those filters is cultural. Does this feel honest? And does this feel true to my experience? And beyond that, because my experience as a Mexican-American is unique, but also not representative of everyone's experience.
Sure.
So to be able to work with a team who empowered us to dig every single thing up. One is the way that I really like to work, and I'm really happy that that was set into the foundation of this process. And two, it made our story better. It didn't just make it more culturally specific. I mean, it did do that, mm-hmm. But I think that also made the storytelling richer, even if you don't come from that culture, because there's a lot of nuance that supports what the characters are feeling and what the family dynamic is, and it creates drama and it creates believability, and that has been one of the most exciting things that I've experienced on this film, particularly because it is a story about a Mexican family and a Mexican tradition.
I kind of wonder whether they'd have that for Ratatouille too, or for Ratatouille. Like, I don't know that they would have thought of it back then.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, to the extent,
but it's interesting.
I think they got the culture of the kitchen right.
Yeah,
yes. I think that was their focus.
Oh, there are many great things, but
yeah,
I think
that's what I'm saying.
These days, everything is so involved internationally.
Yeah,
that you would actually want to represent France in a more, you know what I mean? You would want to like make that extra effort to make sure they were happy too.
Perhaps.
I don't know if they thought about it before this movie. It's interesting.
I don't know. I know that there's a long, strong tradition of research at Pixar, to the point where there was so much research that happened. I remember you said to me one day, like, something like, we have thought about this holiday every day for the last however many years. Like we've spent a lot of time thinking about this holiday.
It's like you only if you celebrate the Día de Muertos from the day that you're born to the day that you die, that's like 80 times.
Yeah.
You know, maybe 90 times.
So not 90 days.
90 days.
Times two or three, depending on where you're celebrating it. You know, like, so maybe 100, maybe half a year.
Yeah,
half a year of your life total thinking about this holiday. We tripled that.
And did you guys do anything for it at school? At Pixar? I mean, was there
At Pixar.
Did you celebrate it particularly during this time?
What was really interesting is that I think at the beginning of the process, a lot of the, especially people who, you know, weren't Mexican or Mexican-American, were aware of the holiday, because we live in Oakland, and in Oakland every year it comes around, they've got big festivals and everything, but the details of it, the meaning of it, a lot of people conflate it with some version of Mexican Halloween, which it's not. But as people saw early screenings of the film, they started working on it, they started researching it, they started learning the reason why it is observed, then everyone got it. And everyone had an emotional connection to the story. So probably like 2014, maybe 2015, when the celebration, the November 1st and 2nd rolled around, everyone was marking it. And we thought at the studio it would be a wonderful opportunity for people, just from a human standpoint, to say, like, we know what this celebration is. We know what it's about. We are putting out a community ofrenda in the studio. If there's someone or people who you would like to commemorate, please bring a photo of them, put them up. And there's you could tell that a lot of people were experiencing that there's a difference in actually practicing active remembrance and putting that photo up and sharing this person with the community than the theoretical understanding of it. And I thought that was one of the most beautiful moments, just as a team, as a studio, to say, like, yes, we're telling a wonderful story. Yes, this comes from a real place. But knowing the power that it has to dig into something that's entirely human and that affects people across cultures. People have often asked me, did you ever think it would do this well in China? Did you ever think it would do this well in the United States or Europe or whatever? And for me personally, when I saw the effect that practice of putting that photo up in the community had for the diverse range of people at the studio, after that moment, it didn't surprise me that this would be a story that would have the power to connect to someone half a world away. Because we're all human. We've all got someone who we're longing to connect with, who we keep in our hearts every day and wish we could, you know, express our love for. And this holiday is a scenario where it makes that real. And that's the value of it. And I'm glad that that translates in the storytelling.
Well, the Chinese seem particularly susceptible to it because they have their own ghosts.
They have their own lives.
Yeah. And it's, yeah, I would say with holidays,
a lot of cultures around the world have holidays like that, where they sort of take one day to remember the people who have passed. I remember when we were down in Oaxaca, it was with this, we were with this family at their house, and then we went to the cemetery to, they were cleaning off their family graves and doing some decorations. And we were just talking, just making conversation. And you know, we were asking all kinds of questions about the holiday and, you know, doing our research and everything. And she sort of turned it back on me, and she was like, what do you guys do? You know, like, what are your cemeteries like? And I said, well, our cemeteries are pretty quiet places. They're pretty respectful. You don't really make a lot of noise there. You know, if you do, people are going to look at you funny. And you know, maybe you go back on the anniversary of that person's death for a few years and you lay some flowers, but maybe then you start missing some years and, you know, life kind of goes on. And as I was explaining this, she was just kind of like this. And when I was done, she was like, that's really sad. And I was like, you're right. You're totally right. It's really sad. I came home and I was like, all right, well, we're starting to celebrate this at home. This is how we're doing it. And we've been celebrating it ever since. I lost my grandmother, the same grandmother. Lost her right before we were working on the movie, and lost my grandfather right after. And it was wonderful, actually. It has been wonderful to put their pictures up and to decorate a little altar in my home. And my kids, who have only now just seen the movie, now finally get it. Like, they finally get a little bit of why we've been doing this for the last few years. I don't know. I hope that the movie gets people to celebrate this holiday who didn't normally, who wouldn't have normally, because I think there is something really, as you're saying, it's just something really healing about not letting go, not seeking that closure. Right? That's a very American idea, that we're going to get over it. We're going to let the person go. We're going to move on with their lives, letting go, letting go, letting go.
Made a hit song for Disney. Sorry.
No, but I mean, that is a very American idea. That when somebody dies, you grieve, and then there is a letting go. Somehow you achieve closure and you move on with your life. And this is antithetical to that. It's like the exact opposite. Like, no, actually the path to healing and happiness and a full, rich life is holding on and ceremonializing that holding on. So it's like, what a great idea. And nobody makes movies about that idea, so let's make a movie about that idea. You know, that seemed like a really cool thing.
Pixar and Disney both have the tradition of making movies that involve death, which always seems like something people are afraid to talk about in real life or in movies or art, or what I mean, better art, high-end art, but
yeah, they,
you know, not necessarily for the kids, but yet the kids.
A friend of mine said, like a year ago, she was asking about the movie, and she was like, she just was like, just tell me like the parents don't die in front of the kid, you know? And I was, cause she had taken her kids to too many movies that she's like, oh man, another parent died, you know? And now my kid's crying and like, oh, what do I do? You know? So I told her, don't worry. Like,
What it actually would have caused a huge problem if Miguel, one of his parents had been dead.
Yeah.
Like, we really needed to create, like, just from a structural standpoint,
to
create a family where the people who had passed on generations before, because I couldn't possibly comprehend a story in which Miguel goes to the land of the dead and he's like, my dead dad, I'm going to put a pause on him for this, like, superstar that I really want to meet.
Is there a way I can do both? Maybe I'll get, and then we go together. No, it's, it does. You're taking me back to all of those those conversations, all those meetings where the snake just ate its own tail. Eventually, you're like,
what if Miguel wanted to stay in the land of the dead?
Yeah, yeah. No. Like, no, he can't stay.
Can't stay in the land.
No, but it's really a great place. He has lots of fun. It's endless amounts of
musicals.
He can't stay.
Yeah.
He can't stay. Yeah. Got to go home.
But you guys figured all that out. Yeah. And you fixed it.
Yeah, because you, sometimes you do have to play kind of idea goalie and be like, you know, that's a great idea and we'll use that in the next movie. But that will blow over the house of cards that is the plot. You know, like it's like you were saying before, like it's a really delicate plot to pull off all of the reveals and the reversals in the second half of the film. It and not tip your hand that there's a lot of tuned, there's a reveal and a reversal. Like it's really delicate plot, and so you do have your filters. I love that. Like you do have to kind of read through and go, okay, am I being too obvious? Is this going to work? Is this line on, you know, on page 5 has to match verbatim to this line on this? So like, how do we make that line up? Like it becomes a mathematical exercise almost. Mm-hmm. So when somebody raises their hand and says, why can't he stay? You go, thank you for your input. We will use that in the next one.
For every one of those you have, there's also one where you dismiss and then
you
take it home, you think about it for 3 hours, you're like, you think about it for 2 weeks, it's like, they were right.
They were right, yeah.
But then it ends up in the movie. Yeah?
And then it ends up in the movie.
If there's time,
if you can. We had 6 years, but we needed another two to add those extra pieces.
Yeah, as it was described to me when I was first started, was that Pixar doesn't release movies. They have movies sort of pried away from their hands and put into theaters. I think they
the
really
funny thing, though, is I think that's
work
true of
on
everybody.
Them forever. Yeah,
I think that's true of every live action movie. You talk to independent filmmakers who make of 8-17 days. You talk to guys who do 6 month shoots. They all are complaining at the end about
they didn't have enough time.
They didn't have time to quite finish everything they wanted to finish.
Yeah, it's an imperfect art form, and I think you just have to sort of embrace and love the imperfection of it, or else you are going to go crazy, or else everything is going to be match point. Mm-hmm.
So roughly in the middle of all this came The Book of Life.
Yeah.
I saw Jorge Gutierrez tweet to you guys, congratulations for the Golden Globe the other night. He's being very supportive of the movie.
Yeah, Jorge has been incredible. We actually met him after we had seen Book of Life. The team was developing the story, and then about a year or a year and a half in, we heard that Book of Life was happening.
I think it might have been earlier than that, because it was something that was like, it may. Mm-hmm. It was in the land of maybe. There's this other competing project, but there's always apparently another competing project with anything. You know, there's always two asteroid movies, that kind of thing. So but I can't think about that today because I have to just do this. I can't wonder what that is. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it was. We had been working on it for quite a long time. Mm-hmm. By the time we heard it was real and getting made, and then it was like, well, what's it about?
Yeah,
and like, what's? Then you're starting to go like, you know, you're scouring the websites for art and early stuff, early reviews, and ultimately it was like we all just went to the movies.
We just went
to the movies that day on opening day, and just like, all right, let's see what they did.
And it was, you know, and that was probably the scariest moment, because, you know, we really want to create an original story. We want to create an original experience, and knowing that both of these things are based on the same source material, there's a certain amount of originality that all of a sudden become. It's like how you can make a Christmas movie, but you can't have Christmas trees, Santa Claus, reindeer. We saw it, and we were, you know, it's a lovely film, but we were extremely relieved to see that the stories were so different that we didn't feel like we needed to restructure or revamp just for the sake of differentiating. And from that point, we have started to get in touch with Jorge, who is the sweetest, the most creative, and the kindest guy. And he's been a big supporter of our project, and we're big supporters of his. As a creator, it was a little bit of a nail biter moment, but yeah. I think, and then you, after the fact, you think about it and you think there are so many Christmas movies. There are so many, why can't there be multiple films about this beautiful celebration? You know, just from the material that we talked about in the room, we could probably, and we probably did, you know, over the course of reboarding, three, four, or five films that don't tread on each other in terms of storytelling, because this is an idea that's so rich with the things you can do and the families that you can show. I guess it doesn't even have to be families, the places that you can explore with this theme of remembrance and history and where you come from, that this is one story and hopefully there's many more in the future.
Yeah. I mean, it was, like I said, it was, like Andrea had said, it was a relief, and it was like, yeah, there can be more than one Christmas movie.
And so there wasn't anything where you had, okay, we should get rid of that to go that way. Because no. I guess his is really about adults in a way.
His is, yeah.
And this is a kid's journey.
Love triangle. And a love
story. It's a love story. It was an Orpheus and Eurydice kind of journey. It was proof of what you're saying, which is like, oh, you can make two things. Like this is not a one trick pony. This idea or this holiday or anything like that. Like this is a pretty deep well, actually. That two movies can be made and have the same visual motifs or things like that, but be so different and have such just have a different effect and different moods and different styles of humor, and like it just was like, oh, they made a different film. Okay, let's go make the one we were making. It was nice.
So when do you guys have a sense of relief that it's done and it's it works and audiences are going to like it and that kind of thing? Is that come the day after opening or the week after opening or the week before? Or?
I started having. Like the thing that I always wanted to do, the finish line for me was always seeing the film in Mexico. From the very first time I went down there to do research and met with the families and sat in their homes and broke bread and talked and everything, I became very aware of like, okay, these people are going to go to a movie theater in a few years, and they're going to see this movie, and this is going to have to deliver. Like I want these people to be so happy when they see this movie. And so I was like, all I want to do is see it in Mexico. All I want to do is see it in Mexico. And so when we went to the Mexico City premiere, that to me was like the sort of the spiritual finish line. Everything after that has been... caviar. It's like, it's just extras. It's just a complete extra. To me, like getting to sit in that room and feel that room, I'll never forget it in my whole life.
And what was the feeling in that room? Did they get every joke? Did they?
They got the more than every joke.
I think the Spanish translation has more to it.
It was the second time we'd seen the movie, and after it was over, my wife and I turned to each other. We're like, I think I like the Spanish version better. Yeah. Like it's just kind of better. Yeah. Like it's hard again.
It's really good.
Can't put your finger on it, but like there's something that draws you even that much further in. But yeah, I mean they.
There's a lot of pride. There is a lot of emotion.
Yeah, it's just so when the Disney logo comes up and
the mariachi
decision to do the mariachi version of When You Wish Upon a Star was made at the very first screening. Mm-hmm. That was a years and years old decision, and so I'd forgotten about it. I'd been like, oh yeah, that decision was made years ago. And so to be in the room when that started playing, and it took everybody a couple notes to figure out what was going on. And when they did, the place erupted in cheers. You couldn't even hear the rest of the song. And we were like, oh my God. we were speechless. And then my favorite part was sort of at the end as all the reveals are happening, this woman in front of me was just gasping, oh, no, no. And I was like, oh, this is so great. to hear it land, you know. Oh, it was just great. It was so invigorating.
I think for me, showing it, leading up to that moment where I could show it to my family and my husband, and so much of the story of this film was motivated by just a desire to say thank you to the people who provided me with the love and support that I needed to be able to achieve anything. And for some reason, leading up to that moment, I did have this kind of weird feeling of, like, I think it was because I was watching a lot of J.K. Rowling interviews, and she kept on talking about how her mom had never heard of the idea of Harry Potter. And in this film that's about saying what you mean to the people who maybe you've never said it to, or, or taking that moment, like, this film summed up everything that I wanted to say to them. And so when that moment came where I got to bring my family to watch the film, the credits rolled. For me, that was like, okay, I did everything I need to do. This is a film that I'm proud of. I'm proud of all of the people who worked on it, and I think it's very special. I don't know how it's going to be received, but at this moment, I can say, like, I did everything I could. I showed it to the people I needed to show it to. And whatever happens after this, at the very least, we can say that it's something that we're very proud of. And to have people react all over the world as much as they have only makes it feel that much better. But, you know, you never count on that.
No. I mean, yeah.
And what do you do now? Are you now a writer? Or are you going back to story?
I don't know. I think right now I'm doing a lot of Cocoa Press. I'm going to take a
world traveler.
I'm a world traveler. I'm going to take a vacation probably once all of the press stuff is finished. And then I think I start going into, to, you know, I would love to write some more. I would love to direct some more. I'd love to develop ideas. I think those conversations are still in progress, but I've enjoyed this experience and learned so much from this experience that I'd love to take those skills and see if I could apply them to a new idea.
And that door is pretty much open at Pixar.
As far as I know.
Well, generally though, they're always looking for the next idea.
They are great about wanting to develop a talent from the studio in the studio and promote from the studio. So,
and from outside and nearby.
Yeah, I live about 10 minutes away from Pixar. I go there every morning and I look over the fence. I
got your own lamp now.
I bought a lamp. I've been there for the past almost year developing another project there with another director. I can't talk about what I've been doing, but I'm sort of in the same pickle I was in a few years ago. I'm like, no, I'm doing something great. Trust me.
I was up there one time and ran into somebody, a writer who I know fairly well, and he was like, hi. Yeah. I was like, okay, I gotta go.
Exactly.
Like, not talking about anything.
Can't talk about it. I went back and I've been, you know, I find it, that's the second time where I've started on a project there with sort of the ground floor, almost basement level of like, what do you want to do? I don't know. Let's make it cool though, you know? And it's like, it's just the most fun time because anything is possible, which is terrifying. But you start making decisions and you start sort of weeding out things and you find a really elegant movie in there. I've been working on that for the last almost year. We'll be sitting back at this table in a few years to discuss that.
And is there any sense when you're going through that process of what the clock might be? Or is it all just...
Like when that movie's due?
Well, not necessarily when that movie's due, but that, you know, in this one, you 3 years and you're a little burnt out and you kind of moved on to other things. Is there a sense of like, okay, this train is going to take 4, 5, 6 years to happen regardless, and I'll be on it as long as I feel it, or they feel me, and we feel each other?
In a way, like I was saying before, like it really helps knowing how things go there and the process, and knowing where a writer fits in to the process in terms of on the whole lifespan of a movie, like when and where the writing takes place, and where I can be most useful to them in crafting the story and providing pages, and when I need to step back, You know, like it's not, it's a my relationship since Coco, my relationship with the studio has been much more fluid. There are a few writers there now who have this kind of more fluid relationship with the studio. You know, it works out. It ends up working out really well, actually.
Well, glad it took as long as it took. Yeah. It's got you where you are.
Worth every moment.
Yeah. Well, and I guess that's the story of the movie on some level is, you know, is to embrace the past and to hang on to the future.
Yeah.
I just love it. You should put that on a poster or something. Maybe I'll be working for Pixar next. Who knows? Thank you, gentlemen.
Thanks
appreciate
so much.
Your time.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
Thank you so much.